And welcome back, Sanitarium. I'm the RPG Chick, and this is where we are, the Sanitarium. We have a bunch of doors we haven't gone through, and found ourselves into this section, so... We're looking for Azo. Master Azo? I'm gonna interview Graham. Wherever he might be.
Got it.
Screams in the night. We've read these descriptions, these little sayings. I can't say much for these accommodations. They said I can't leave yet. So I have no idea where this guy Graham is. If I go in there, let's check down here. Wasn't there another? Oh. Alright. Thought there was another place in there that we hadn't gone. First door we've opened. There's Azo himself. I don't want to come out and ask him. Something churns and bubbles in this tank. We're supposed to be talking to Graham first. We can't open that. The copper wires and conduits are shiny. The device is warm to the touch.
I can do that.
I don't want to pick it right now. Churns and bubbles. A round-faced, balding man turns to face you. His upper lip is pulled upward slightly by his pointed nose, exposing his upper teeth when he scowls. Which I guess he's doing right now.
What is the meaning of this?
I'm not, I'm looking for an expert on awakenings. I don't have time to give you directions. Go bother somebody else. I'd like access to the North Ward. I have a question. Those patients are in isolation for a reason. Yeah, perception. Okay. I really don't want to push it, but I don't have a lot of options now to just exit out. Your forehead seems damp all of a sudden. Perhaps I should discuss your insubordination with the head warden.
You smug cretin. How dare you come down here and meddle? You have no idea the importance of my research.
He balls up his fist and digs his teeth into his index finger, a growl simmering beneath his breath and a deep scowl compressing his face.
Fine. Speak to them for all the good it'll do you. I'm sure the discussions will be fascinating.
He pulls a heavy key from one of his pockets and nearly slams it down on the floor before handing it to you. Farewell.
Hmm.
I received a key to North Ward from Azor. He was not pleased to give it. Is Graham in the North Ward? Yeah, he is. So we needed to get it from him anyway, so... just as well. We'll be on our way. I don't want to accuse him and send him running or fighting us, and I want to find out from this Graham guy like we're supposed to. Okay, so we're back here. Check these doors here. I don't like the way these things stand. They're very threatening. Unlock with North Ward key. Okay, that's where we're supposed to be going. Let me check on these wicks. Trying to be very methodical here and explore everything. I guess they're behind that door. Skull of Burst of Summer Flame. Quickly generates an explosive flash of flame, inflicting burn damage to anyone in the area of effect. Short cast time. Awesome. And 18 gold. The White That Wends. Do we have this book? The White That Wends. Sounds familiar. It's a river, isn't it? I think. We only have one. How long have I been wandering? I can no longer tell. The days in endless white, the cold breath of the wilderness biting at my neck. All I feel is the insistent hand of the wind pushing me forward. Where is it taking me? Where did it start? On the boat? Was there a boat? I remember one. A storm and disaster. If I dwell on it long enough, my mind rebels. So I walk, and she appears to be. How many times has it been? Once? Have I seen her before, or is this the first time? Did she ever leave? All my mind can do is ask questions. Each question leads to another question. The answers frighten me. So I walk. She stands with her head cast down. Long white hair hangs in front of her face, obscuring it from my view. She holds out a hand, pale, thin, palm up. She wants my help. She wants my soul. Whoops. Something's... God. I'm not sure if it's my mouse, guys, or if it's the control. Something screams, inhuman and primal. It overtakes me from behind, wrapping me in a terrifying blanket of sound. My skin contracts as chills course through me. I turn to face my pursuer and see only a vast white emptiness. She is gone, like every time before. Was this the first time? Has she gone before? My stomach answers with a growl. Hunger. The beast consumes me from the inside, and there is no stopping it. I must eat. I see water. Am I seeing it now? Is this a memory? Confusion slips its fingers inside my head and murmurs softly. I cannot quite hear it. I strain to no avail. The water remains. It must be here. I drop to my knees and hear the whisper-like crack of the ice beneath my knees. I am sitting in the lee of an ice mountain. The protection it provides does little to prevent the wind from driving the pins of snow into my flesh. I am shaking. Where is my left hand? I move it. Nothing. I look down and see it moving. It is wet and caked with ice. My head falls back against the ice, and I press the edges of my memory. My brain whispers back with a soft cracking sound and a scream. Wood on wood, tearing, cracking. I close my eyes against the onslaught. She appears before me again, Again? Time fragments and blows around me like the snow that obscures my vision. I am walking. My hand is on fire. I fear the needles piercing my fingers as she reaches hers out to me. She raises her head, black eyes staring blankly. Her mouth opens and closes, but if she speaks, I cannot hear it. The scream again, closer this time. If I still had emotion, I would be quaking. I turn as I have so many times before to see what monster has found me, and she is there behind me. She puts her hand on my chest. The cold burns me through my clothes. She leans in. Her mouth presses against my ear. We are waiting. I open my eyes. I lie on the ground. I see torn fabric, rocks, a broken wooden box, an unsuccessful campfire. Where did it come from? Did I make it? How did I get here? I roll onto my back, unable to stand. Exhaustion sits on my chest and holds me down. She stands above me. I see frozen tears on her cheeks. She does not move. She does not threaten me. But I know this is the end. Her mouth opens. The inhuman scream that erupts from within her digs through the blackness that shrouds my mind, and I see her. The wood that tore beneath her feet. The water that swallowed her. She fades, replaced by the face of the devil that has followed me. Was it always there? In my madness, did I view it in a different form? Is anything in my mind true? Time bleeds. My vision shimmers, distorting the face that approaches. Its dark eyes watch closely as it walks forward. Its fur is matted and stained. Its fangs glisten in the fading light. Its enormous hands, tipped with jagged blades, rise above my head. I close my eyes. I am coming. Interesting. Cool. Okay, so there's wicks. There be wicks. I don't know why I'm kind of nervous about the wicks, so let's just save the game, I guess. I'm afraid if they attack me and I fight them back, it'll be something like the guards attacking me and these constructs attacking me, that kind of thing. I can't open that? I only worn once. After that, it's your skin. Well, I can't open it. I don't know. I'd like to go in there, but don't seem to be able to. So let's go to the north thingy. The north ward. Ta-da! And here we are. Oh, we can talk to these people through the jail cells. We can't open them. Or through the whatever cells. Is this my face? Tell me. What is this? This is not my face. Alright. I guess there's no one in there to talk to. Thundering sky, rain of blood. Innocence must drown. The flames must be free. Something. Fed. Watch to... Too much silence? What? Oh, what are you saying? Can't do anything with that. This is Graham. This man has a look in his eyes of a hunted animal, and at your approach he staggers backward to the far corner of his cell, halfway appearing as though he would climb the walls if he could get him farther away from you. He cries out, a bizarre primal utterance like nothing you have heard. Number two is funny. I need to ask you some questions. Graham stares at you blankly. It is unclear whether he understands you or not, but his panic has momentarily subsided. He opens his mouth to speak, but the words that come out are half-formed, as though his tongue were cut out. They are impossible for you to discern, if indeed they are words at all. Durant says, "The mutilations of animancy, crueler than any torture, to disfigure the soul. Let us return the favor to the animancers of this shit heap." Azo, Azo. He's definitely going to react once we say Azo. I sense that. I feel that would be true. I'm going to learn them whether or not you can speak. Perception check. Or perception ability, whatever you call it. You're afraid. Do certain visitors make you afraid? He looks at you with uncertainty. Slowly, tentatively, he steps closer to the front of his cell, and as he does so, for the first time, you can experience his soul within your ken. It is misshapen, as though maimed by some jagged instrument, and large expanses of it have been gouged out entirely. My God. You feel no barriers of resistance. If you wanted to, you could look further into Graham's soul. Yes, let's do so. There's that sound. I miss that sound when we look at people's souls. You project out towards the maimed soul in front of you, merging with it, its confusion and fear becoming yours as it whisks you into its depths. You're in your cell. A key turns. The door creaks open on neglected hinges. Thoughts come to you in waves, incomplete, broken, fearful. Standing at the door is a rotund, balding man. His upper teeth and pointy nose remind you of a rat. He beckons, apologetic. You don't want to go. Anything else? In your mind is a single word, and the word is no, but it dissolves before it reaches your lips. You press against the back wall, cornered. You cry out. In darkness, you fight against unseen restraints. You cannot move your arms or legs. The man walks into the room carrying a lit candle, its meager flame casting long shadows across books and machinery. Straps bind your arms and legs. Cold metal circumscribes the crown of your head and the breadth of your chest. The man is sorry. He is in need of raw materials. They dismantled his work, and he needs another source. He needs to show them he was right. He thanks you. Then he turns a knob, and you feel yourself begin to crack from within, and you can feel pieces of you torn away, like having your insides chewed by a horde of rats, and you are screaming a scream you can barely hear. Continue. Another night. Heavy footsteps outside your door. Coming for you. You look through a slit in your door. The flesh giant, the artificial being, just outside, but facing left, facing the end of the hall. The boy there. The boy looks with interest at the giant, then collapses to the floor like a shed snakeskin. The giant convulses for a moment, then rights itself, turns away, and leaves. It's odd. Graham looks at you, still wild-eyed, but somehow more present. He nods at you, then walks to the back of his cell. Strange behavior for that boy at the far end. Graham stares at the floor in some half-conscious state. The boy at the far end, huh?
These poor people. This isn't the treatment that they were promised upstairs by the cushioned seats and lush carpets.
Definitely not, Kanna.
Is that the cure for soul sickness? To be thrown into a cell and subjected to the whims of your captor?
What were you expecting? He winces. I have seen the sick and the mad exiled, or else treated like contagious vermin, but I cannot believe that this is the kindest alternative. But if all were treated like this, the sanitarium would never survive. What did these patients do to warrant such conditions? Here's the source of all that knowledge you were so giddy about. He grimaces. It is one thing to be told as much, another to see it yourself. Let's be on our way. This place gnaws at the soul. Got that right. Is the boy in there? Nothing searchable around here. Alright, boy. Usgrim. A willowy adolescent boy stands in the center of his cell, gawkish and stoop-shouldered. He stares straight ahead, the occasional blink his only movement, and it is unclear whether he registers your presence at all behind his glassy, doll-like eyes. In this state, the barriers between your soul and his are thin and porous, easily bypassed if you should wish it. Yeah, let's go for it. You close your eyes and edge forward towards the boy's soul, and as you near, a sudden malaise comes over you. You are cold and warm all at once, sweating and shivering and straining for breath, as you did on the caravan journey. The soul you approach is the wrong one, a parasitic plant that strangles its host. It is predatory and pitiless, and you have crossed paths with it before. Too late does it occur to you to retract, and already you feel yourself plunging into some interminable abyss of thought and memory. This doesn't sound very good now, does it? You are standing in a cell now, the same cell in the sanitarium. The halls are moonlit and empty, and you are waiting. At the far end of the ward, the door opens, revealing a flesh golem in silhouette beneath the stone archway. It makes its usual rounds, the same stops every time, the misbegotten child of despondent creators. When the construct is closed, you coil yourself up and spring forward, passing out of the boy's body as though it were a membrane. You can sense his body behind you collapsing to the floor, a puppet whose strings are cut. So we're seeing the same thing from the point of view of this thing, this parasitic thing. You are rushing toward the golem now, bodiless as a gust of wind. Quickly, you think to yourself, quickly, and you feel the strength hemorrhaging from your soul as you dart towards the makeshift abomination. You pass into the golem shell and overtake the soul implanted within it, encircling it, suppressing it, and contained in this new vessel, you are strong again. You step heavy-footed down corridors, unheeded by the other constructs and scrutinized only by the wary, untrustworthy eyes of the mad, coming at last to an office piled with books and scribbled papers and the perverse implements of animancy. You set your oversized hands upon a large machine, a nest of globes and tubes and coils in the center of the room, and go to work, bending wires and unsettling alignments. Your surroundings are pulled past you, or perhaps you are pulled past them, and they dissolve into a blur. When they settle into place again, you are outside on a clear day, standing in front of a crowd stacked high above you on the tiered seats of an amphitheater. You are acting for the crowd, standing deliberately still, but this is no play. A balding man with rodent-like features is strapping you to a machine. It's gotta be Azo. The one you had tampered with. You see your arms for the first time, short and fleshy, unmistakably those of a little girl, but this body is not truly yours. Your mind still holds the same determination, the same hard-heartedness as before. The body itself is cold and vacuous. Unlike the others, this one has no soul of its own. The man speaks, and the crowd applauds with an enthusiasm worthy of a hero's entrance. "Bear witness," he says, and he pulls a lever. The machine shivers and sparks, and a bead of sweat rolls down the side of the man's brow, but the crowd's apprehension quickly gives way to awe as a crystal globe fills with a radiant mist that casts the entire theater aglow. He opens a valve, and the glow crawls through a tube along a length of copper wiring that runs to a set of electrodes beneath your armpits. You feel nothing when it reaches you, as it should be, for you have been leading his work astray periodically for some time. Excuse me, altering notes and settings and playing puppeteer for Hollowborn. But you make it look how people would expect it to look when a body is infused with a soul. In a moment, the machine goes dark, and the man unstraps you, eyeing you with a scientist's concern. He looks back up at the crowd. "Behold," he says, but there is obvious hesitation in his voice. Slowly, you take a plodding step forward, then another, and another. You look up at the man, giving him the eye contact of which no hollowborn is capable, and the crowd gasps. The man looks relieved. How do you feel? He asks at a volume meant for the crowd, and this is the moment. At the top of your lungs, you let out a piercing shriek. The man comes towards you, his hand outstretched, but you run the other way, back to the machine. With all your strength, you drive your head into the crystal globe, and it shatters, streaking your head with warm blood. Sorry, guys. You drive your head down onto the surface of the machine, again and again, drawing panicked screams from the crowd. And by the time the man reaches you, your body has already ceased proper function and merely twitches on the cold ground. Satisfied, you depart the corpse in search of another unsuspecting host. Who could they put their faith in animancy now? You are pulled again from your surroundings, transcending the boundaries of memories and lifetimes, deeper and deeper past betrayals and murders and lies upon lies that form the thick webbing of plots beyond mortal comprehension. You settle at last on a room you have seen before, expansive, with a tall device encasing an Adra monolith at its center. The room is filled with people, and the people all look at the device. You are yanked suddenly back to reality, and the once catatonic boy in the cell is looking directly at you, appraising, calculating. There is no mistaking now that it is the soul of the man who caused your awakening that gazes out from that borrowed husk. A watcher. I believe we share a common past. I'm just looking for some answers. Is that so? He makes no effort to hide his disinterest, but he continues to search your eyes. He makes a slight grunting noise, and his eyes soften for an instant, and it seems, for that moment, that he recognizes you. He opens his mouth to speak, then seems to think better of what he was about to say. His jaw tightens. I know your look. You hunger. Hunger for answers that delude you, or elude you. It gnaws at your soul. It usurps your reason for being. You are like everyone. I will help you let go. He dodges backward with a startling grace, putting himself out of reach. On his face there is no malice, only the dispassion of a farmer putting down a sick animal. Then suddenly he slumps forward. Is he going to try to inhabit my soul now? Or my body? Oh, crap. Oh. He's possessing those things. And now we have to fight Graham, too? Alright, guys. I thought it was heading for me to inhabit my body. I have our wizard run back there. See if we can get that off. I'm not gonna hit him first. Some fire. Oh, good. We almost got rid of one flesh construct. Crazed patient. Soul shock off of Adair. How about consecrated ground? Does that work again? Oh, from caster? Okay, so I just activate it. Okay. Another fireball. Okay, she's out of focus. Meaning Theodess. Where is she anyway? Theodess, okay. Oh my god! Pelagina! Lay hands on yourself as. Slay and fillet. Did she cast it already? Do it again. Let her lay on hands. Amplified thrust again. Healing. Oh, there's that Edelman guy. Oh, I don't want to kill the Midnight Man. Necrotic Lance.
No, I need something stronger.
Cool, you got him. Going all out here.
Lava.
Is that 101? Oh, that's 10 and then 11, I think. That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
Again. What are these guys doing? There's nobody left? Wow. Well, there's runes above this door. Who gave them all clubs and daggers? What the hell? Vessel flesh.
Sure. No problem.
The chains grown with added weight. Crescent bite marks pit the edges of the cot. People are all screaming now. This bucket reeks of awful. It's pretty awful. Ooh, a rite of walking shadows. Rites are a special type of magic scroll, or a special type. The ritual contained on the scroll allows the reader to grant a specific skill bonus to all his or her allies for a long duration. Oh, it's a slow cast speed, range 10 meters. plus 3 stealth for 2 minutes. And 97 gold. Man! Nothing in here. So let's see if there's anything in these cells here. Oh, there's another one. Oh, they're all gonna fight us now. Hit the thing.
Sure.
Ooh, is there something there?
Let's see what lies this way.
I saw something. See that? Oh, no, that's... No, never mind. Start at the top. Check all these rooms. Nothing in them. Okay, I don't know if we're gonna have to fight our way out of here or what. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. And enduring, grow strong.